Chapter 1. Come autumn, the eyes reap color against the lengthening shadows and the night that seals them closed. As if nature, having already given spring to love and summer to leisure, made a season especially for dreamers, its days hazy and heavy-lidded, its evenings haloed and smudged by rain, the hour's hypnotic passage, sleeping all who, dazed and doubled in themselves, fall leaf-like under its spell. Men we take to be awake seem not quite so. Presentable, bright-eyed, facing the day, possibly in the habit of retiring, already groomed for their appointment with tomorrow, they come upon us in our fog of somnolence, and, reminded of rest, let their heads sink back into the sky's great pillow, forgetting their progress. As for those with nowhere to go, or no particular rush, they seem to have only just climbed out of bed, their clothes creased, as if yesterdusk's circadian sign had them give up their undressing, and the crack of dawn took away the reason to go on. Drowsy, practically dozing on their feet, they let their lids droop low enough to screen their dreams, with half an eye still on the noir of reality. In autumn, such absences and bifocal vision come naturally, spreading like an insuppressible yawn. Chapter 2. I no longer remember the day we met. Unemployed for going on a year, pondering a future set agape by idleness, I had slipped by degrees into a not unpleasant state of semi-consciousness, leaving time to erode in peace what little remained of my savings. As my thoughts hewed ever closer to my surroundings, cocooned in ambient noise and newsprint, I rustled through the daily papers and, nursing a tall glass, looked out at the street teeming behind the window pane. Childless and sans disciple, I had a corner of tedium to myself, but no life, no occupation, and no prospects to speak of, save for a standing invitation from a retired bookbinder and a psychoanalyst, an elderly couple, to visit their country estate. I drew as much mileage as possible from this offer I could never in reality bring myself to accept, imagining a house with its wings and empty guest rooms, a surrounding garden and galleries stretching beneath all the way to Paris to join a mycelium of abandoned mines and catacombs, kept me going even when I myself was in no mood to budge. To languish in the capital as I did was simultaneously to while away the days until I could see myself boarding a southeasterly train, sure to disembark, where the air was clearer, crisper, where the grass was grizzled by frost, where the wine tasted of hummus, and my much-awaited hibernation could commence without further delay. My hosts, quite wrongly, presupposed in me a readiness to keep them company in their passing house, in which time, reduced to whispers, ticked off on a list as long as life the varieties of pain. I had promised them nothing of the sort. It was on one of those wet afternoons, steps fugacious on decaying matter, that my constant reverie opened wider than usual. Intoxicated by dreams of romance in a primeval forest, I had settled down on a park bench and, for all I know, had been asleep for a good half hour, when suddenly the boards shifted beneath me, as loose or rotted ones do if another sits upon them, leading my confused mind to conclude it was the superb creature I pursued barefoot through knee-deep underbrush who, having yielded at last, came to rest, light as swan down, right beside me. I was about to discover its face,